A great job running the meeting. Since, as mayor, you have so much experience.
I can at least call attention to the individual items.
Yes.
Is that acceptable with everyone?
Yeah.
So welcome to the CCWD and SAM Joint Recycled Water Committee meeting of Monday, January 30th, 2017. It's our first Recycled Water Committee meeting of the year. And I'd like to go to item one and have a roll call, please.
We want to just go, we typically just go around and introduce who we are and who we're from.
Ken Coverdell, Coastside County Water District.
Debbie Ruddick, City of Half Moon Bay.
Bill Huber, Montero Water and Sanitary District.
Scott Boyd, Montero Water and Sanitary and SAM.
Beverly Marshall from SAM.
Bruce Russell, Ocean Colony Partners.
Christian Bodivadi from SAM.
Okay.
Mary Rogan, CCWD.
Dave Dixon, CCWD. Clement Feldmeyer, Montero Water and Sanitary District.
Member of the public.
Yeah, Catherine Slater Carter, member of the public.
Okay. So item two, do we have any members of the public who would like to address the Recycled Water Committee?
Do we, if I could ask a question, do we ever pledge allegiance in this group? I would like to move that we pledge allegiance.
Yeah, it's probably a good time after this last weekend, huh?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay, let's do that. Let's have a pledge of allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you very much.
Thank you for suggesting it.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Okay, item three is old business. And it looks like we don't have any old business. So item four, new business. Could we have a motion and a second to approve the minutes of October 17th, 2016?
I would like to add an item which goes to the issue of a rather lengthy discussion we had last time about the timing and next steps. CCWD expressed in terms of their next steps, somewhere between 5 and 10 years.
Okay.
Some of the SAM members expressed a concern about the anticipated delay. We would like to see it sooner. So I'd like to see that in the minutes, please.
Yeah, I do recall that conversation. Yeah.
I do too. And I think it should also be added that there were comments from Bruce Russell about two and a half years was thrown out in that discussion as well, which I think would be important to note.
Yes, you might want to acknowledge, if one can recall, the points of discussion on the issue of timing.
We can go back and watch the video, that part of it, and get that piece of it.
Oh, fun.
Yeah.
No.
And so do we want to table the minutes until the next meeting and approve them after they're
I read through them. Other than that, that's the only comment I had.
So I move we approve the minutes as amended.
Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Motion carries unanimously. And Granada Sanitary District member Rick Lohman is joining the board at 7:08 p.m.
We're going to wait for you to get in.
Somebody slow life down a little bit.
Mm-hmm. And you're retired.
What?
Remember, you're retired.
I'm tired.
Really tired. That's what retired means.
Retired. I put
that's
the tires
right.
back on.
Yeah, that's right. Recycle, reuse, retire. So just to bring you up to speed, we have covered items 1 through 4A. We've approved the minutes of the previous October 17 meeting.
Mm-hmm.
And we're moving on to item B, 4B, the SRT 25% Design Task 1 Alternative Analysis Report.
So basically, we wanted to bring this to your attention. We haven't really had a meeting yet since all of the approval was received to proceed with the 25% design. So we wanted to update this group on where we are. The SAM board did approve moving forward with the 25% design with SRT, with the caveat that the tasks that were authorized, each task had to be completed and approved by the SAM board before we could move forward to the next task. And so at last week's SAM board meeting, SRT presented the task one, which was the alternative analysis report, which was attached for today's meeting. And the SAM board did approve and receive that and authorize SRT to proceed with task two. So that's where we are with that timeline. Kishan, do you want to just give a brief synopsis of the report?
Yeah, just like to add that the alternative analysis report was completed by SRT 4 weeks before time. And so we are well ahead of schedule now, and they've been given approval to move ahead with task two, which means at the end of task two, we will get an idea about the tentative cost of the project, which is a 25% design cost. And that is, we hope to complete it by end March. The earlier schedule was to finish it by end April, as per their proposal. But since we've gained 4 weeks, we should be able to finish it by end March. And basically, in the technical memorandum, SRT has considered three alternatives for the recycled water project, meaning the equipment and the piping and all that. And finally, boiled down to alternate one, which is most feasible considering the scenario at the treatment plant. And also looked at two different methods of distribution as to how they could take the pipeline crossing the creek. And finally, they have arrived at one particular thing, which has been mentioned in the technical memorandum. So that's the gist of the technical memorandum, where no costs have been indicated as of now. Now they would start working on it and then come back.
Do any members of the committee have questions for staff or comments? Ken?
In my reading of the three alternatives, is it appropriate to ask questions about the three alternatives to staff? Have you reviewed this and agreed with the selection of SRT?
Yes, we have. In fact, all the three alternatives were discussed with the staff, with SAM's staff, and then we arrived at alternate one because that was the best suitable to the scenario right now existing in the treatment plant.
Okay.
The primary clarifier, which had been selected, was not in use, and the aeration basin was also not in use. So we decided to use those for the recycled water project.
Can I continue?
Please.
Sure.
Okay. How does alternative two differ from alternative one in terms of the lab? I've seen the pictures. Because in my reading of it, and I guess I would ask if you agree, it looked to me like the most square footage available would be generated in alternative two. 2,808 square feet as opposed to I can't remember, 1,500 or something like that of space. So I was, do you agree with not having more available space?
What's your concern?
Expansion.
Okay.
Creating more than simply water for one customer. Hmm. Because as the purchaser of water, we would like to have more. So we don't see any reason to limit the space, and we're very concerned, as was the engineer from Halfen Bay, about the physical layout of the conditions here. And it looked to me like two was very similar to one, but it gave more space. It wiped out parking or something, I think, was the issue. But, you know, and I'm sure that parking is at a premium, but water, I think, is going to be far greater in value than parking going forward. And so I just wondered how you felt about that.
Yeah, at the same time, alternate one is, if you realize it is for the primary clarifier, we're going to have one above the other. Mm-hmm. So there's more scope for expansion, and it's all in modular packs. So it is possible to accommodate within that. That's why we didn't want to take away some extra space just to spread it out.
Yes.
So this is a modular concept where it sits one on top of the other.
Oh, okay.
So
it's like Legos.
So that's what's shown in there.
We're building the whole thing from Legos.
Oh, okay, cool. I like that. Yeah. I think I can help you with some workers.
You can do that.
My kids.
Yeah.
I don't know if you're able to visualize the rendering, which was not very clear.
It's really hard for me to visualize. Yeah.
But that's the way it is, because we're going to have the clarifier, which is already existing.
Right.
On top of that is what we're going to build the RO system. And then it's going to be housed also, I know that, you know.
Well, I understood the access around. I mean, I could visualize that. I didn't realize that we could, well, you know, build multiple stories. So if we wanted to go from 50% RO to 100% RO, we would just stack these units on top of each other?
Yep.
Oh, that's very good news.
A tower.
Oh, good. And is there a height restriction in there?
I was waiting for that one.
I'm just curious.
Sure, once we get to the EIR, that'll be the first thing that'll come up.
Visual impact.
Unless, I guess, if we put nesting habitat for raptors, maybe then.
There you go.
Right on top?
Yeah, don't you think?
Yeah.
Very good.
So Keeshan, if I read it right, we're taking one existing tank that's used for the sewer plant and converting that over to be used for this purpose, right, for the recycled water? Okay, so that theoretically reduces the capacity of the plant. Is that correct?
No.
Okay.
That's not being used right now.
Okay.
Therefore, we're making use of that particular tank.
And that was actually something that was the board wanted clarified in the report from SRT, and I believe it's in here that they needed to state unequivocally that this alternative that they're recommending would not affect the capacity or endanger the permit, so that we could still meet all of our permit requirements with these changes.
Okay, is there any other unused capacity that could be devoted to this?
That's a good question.
Okay, so that when you build a plant, it's built for a certain capacity, which means it needs all of those components to meet that capacity. When you take one component off, that means that the others are not out of balance. And so that, is there also some other unused tanks or other apparatus that could be used for this?
Yeah, that's what we've used. We've used clarify number 4 and irrigation basin number 2.
Okay.
These two have been used in this recycled water project.
Okay. But there's no other?
There's no other.
For future expansion that could be used?
Correct.
Okay.
And so the primary concern with staff was that we could still operate. Obviously, we wouldn't want to do anything that would jeopardize our ability to meet our primary concern, which of course is our permit. And so that was definitely something that SRT took into consideration, as well as part of the design was staff was very concerned about the ingress and egress of vehicles, the sludge hauling, all of that, because we have a very difficult turn radius. So we, and because of my understanding of the habitat surrounding the treatment plant, we really don't have a lot of options for expanding out or utilizing any open space that's around here for things like parking. So while I understand your concerns with parking being, you know, maybe secondary to water, for us, the ability to actually do our daily work is very important, and we wouldn't want to jeopardize that by using that space. So I think staff is comfortable with the recommendations. And the other thing is that, because staff was weighing in on it, was to point out any issues that there might be with regards to the treatment plant's ability to do day-to-day operations and anything that needs to be replaced or repaired or whatever in order to not only meet our permit, but to meet the expectations of CCWD with the recycled water. So part of that will be reflected in the cost, would be anything else that we have to do in order to make the plant itself so that we have the ability to meet our permit and the recycled water.
Yeah, so the redundancy and the reliability of the treatment plant is not being compromised.
But the overall capacity is being reduced.
No,
the SAM board took this up and discussed the upgrade at the last meeting. This is not being compromised.
So one could watch the video.
Okay.
Keeshan, weren't there some additional enhancements that you've already done which helped out in this problem, that some of the other units are now operating a lot more efficiently now than the original design, because it's been a million years.
In the aeration basin, they've got the DO.
So now it's just not necessary because everything else is at a much higher level of efficiency. And so they can still take things out of commission to do repairs, and replacements while still maintaining, you know, all of our capacities and stuff like that. So that was really important to Sam, is that we don't all of a sudden have to repair something and shut the plant down to do it.
So if we could turn our attention towards actually moving forward, Sam has done its part. CCWD asked Sam to go spend $200,000 to get this work done. We've committed that money. We have something in front of you that reflects our commitment. And I'd like to talk about how we're getting this thing moving. Because now we're putting up more money than we've already put up. And I'd like to see us start to assemble a schedule.
Can I ask another question before we do that?
Sure.
I'm sorry, I didn't have a chance to read this before tonight. On page 15 or 5, it indicates that our storage capacity, I think, was 9 million gallons, but sedimentation is reduced to 6.1. Future dredging of the ponds is considered by us and will increase the capacity back to 9 million. That's the way I'm reading this paragraph. I don't think that's accurate. I mean, there's only one pond that we can dredge. Two of the other ponds would involve some really serious processing wetland issues. I don't know. I think we can increase our current capacity by about 1.5 million gallons. So, and I don't know what our current capacity is. We may have given them something that I don't have in front of me. But if this is suggesting that all three of these ponds can be dredged to increase the capacity back to an original capacity of 9 million, I don't think that's accurate. And I can't tell in the report, they're assuming that 9 million, the alternative analysis assumes that we can hold 9 million gallons. I don't know whether that's critical to their assessment. I can't see where there's any analysis of how much they think we need to hold in order for them to pump 18 hours a day and for you to not have to hold. So I need to check that, because I think the accurate number is, I think we are down to about 6. The two ponds that we can dredge without serious environmental issues will give us about 1.5 million. It won't return us to our original capacity. We're not planning on dredging 3 ponds. We're only dredging the one on 15. So I can check whether, I don't know where these numbers must come from somewhere we gave them. But I think they may have misunderstood that we could dredge all of our ponds.
Sounds like we need to go back to them, clarify these points, and especially, most importantly, find out the criticality of the
Line. I mean, maybe 7.5 million is more than enough, but if it's based on 9 million, I don't know why they indicate why that is. The second thing I don't quite understand is, maybe I might have this wrong, on page 12, they say that they're going to pump 900 gallons per minute of recycled water through a 12-inch diameter pipeline to our well field, and they're going to do that for 18 hours a day. Unless I'm wrong, 900 gallons per minute times 60 minutes is times 18 hours is 972,000 gallons. And our average consumption is 500. I don't know why the 18 hours. I just don't understand. I think if you take
maybe they mean for a period up to or something.
I don't know, but it says they're going to do 18 hours every day.
Maybe within an 18-hour window.
I don't.
So we need clarification on that.
Over 18 hours daily. Over 18 hours daily.
That's a peak.
Yeah, I think it's just talking about the capacity of the pump.
Well,
972,000 is a lot more than anyway.
Well, there's only a few days a year where we need 800. Yeah. Our average is about 5 to 550. I'm sure they use, I don't, if they're running at 18 hours, I'm sure they use that number for electrical.
I think if you look at the wording of that sentence, it could be read, it's assumed pumping from the recycled water clear well would occur over an 18-hour span daily, not necessarily nonstop.
I see, X number of hours
I think it
during
might,
an 18-hour
period. It might just be a wording thing.
I think there's somewhere else in here, Scott, where it says 18 hours. But I just looked.
Why would you clarify? Get clarification.
Those are the only two questions I have here. But I want to make sure that they're not planning on us having 9 million gallons of capacity for some reason.
Rain for rent, they offer these things.
If they can come get permits for the other two ponds, have at it.
There's not another 36 holes down there?
No, and I think there's two ponds where I don't think.
Large plastic bag floating.
Yeah, we have those ponds.
Ken?
The other question I had in reading the report is, you know, in a lot of the meetings I've heard long winded description of having to someday abandon the outfall into the ocean. And so my concern is that all these systems are going to pump the waste side of the RO into the outfall. So is that practical, and is that practical for how long, and what's the impact of, I mean, isn't the stuff that comes out of RO pretty wild stuff? Stuff that no one wants?
If I could ask, I don't know that it's particularly helpful to characterize it with the kind of language you used.
Well, how, please characterize it. I'm not a sanitary sewer guy.
Well, I think I'm referring to the word long-winded. I don't think it's particularly helpful. We're trying to establish a collegial arrangement here, and that seemed rather disparaging. We've got a sewer operation to run here, and we take it very seriously. And if we sometimes go on at length, I hope you'll forgive the gravity with which we take our responsibilities.
Well,
I don't tell you how to run yours, right? I think your concern's a fine one that we should talk about, the disposal of the RO waste. Keisha, do you have thoughts on what happens if we no longer have an outfall?
Right now we're assuming that the RO brine will go to the outfall, and there's been no talk about stopping the outfall right now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we're looking at the outfall as a critical piece of infrastructure that is non-optional to us at this point, but something that might take tens of millions of dollars to repair should something catastrophic happen to it. So as risk management, of course, we're going to be looking for alternatives to just continually propping that thing up. Right now, it's working for us fine and can serve as an integral part of anything that we do. But we'd be remiss to not look at what we might be able to do instead.
So what's an alternative? I mean, let's say that, we've heard discussions, worst case scenario, somehow the permit is lifted, or, you know, somehow that outfall is impacted, or, you know, there's been discussion of somebody potentially hooking it with a net or hooking it with a, you know, an anchor. I mean, I've heard these characterizations. So, frankly, I'm not trying to disparage anyone about long-winded. Excuse me. I've heard a lot of discourse on this topic, and so I'm concerned because I think the material that we're going to depend on pumping out there is pretty serious stuff for the ocean.
Well, it is marine sanctuary.
Is yeah. that not
we're, we're more dependent on it than the recycled water project itself would be. So let's talk about that, you know, as a SAM responsibility. Nobody's looking at walking away from that responsibility. And any alternative is going to require some very careful thought and engineering. So,
right. But essentially,
at this point, there is no plan on record to do away with that. If we're able to manage to reuse and redirect the resource that's flowing through that pipe into productive use on land, of course we're going to try to do that. Along the way, we'll face some challenges. That brine may be part of that challenge. Mm-hmm.
I guess that what my concern is I think that it would be nice to see some analysis from SRT or from someone as to what happens in that event. And I'm not trying to disparage or put a brake or slow the thing down or anything like that, but a concern. I'm very concerned about the environment.
Well, to what end? We rely on that all day, every day, 365 or 366 days a year. There's no plan to change the outfall.
And why were we worried about it? What am I missing? I mean, we've discussed it numerous times, okay, so it must be an issue.
It is an issue for SAM to solve long term. If we're able to divert a lot of water so it doesn't need to go through that pipeline, that's a good thing, which allows us to consider moving away from it. But I don't think anybody is talking about willy-nilly just turning a valve and shutting the thing off. We've got responsibilities that aren't going away. So why don't we proceed in the knowledge that SAM has a commitment long term to making sure that there is an appropriate discharge of anything that needs to go out.
Yeah,
well, that doesn't need to be part of the recycle project, because its recycle project is dependent on the current operational characteristics of this plant. We're able to handle it, and it's time to move ahead.
Yeah, my family is dependent on the long-term sustainability of this environment, so that's the way I see it, and I think it's an important issue. And I think it's fine that you don't see it as important.
Oh, no.
I'm just advising that we take a little time while we go through the study.
Well, let's be real plain, Ken. I've been the one doing the long-winded talks about the outfall and the long-term big capital risk to this agency if we should sustain some kind of catastrophic failure. If a catastrophic failure happens, we're going to have to deal with it at the time. and it's not going to be something that a whole lot of planning is going to be able to deal with, other than trying to minimize our dependency on it. This project is one way that we can minimize up to 800,000 gallons a day dependency on it. So trying to turn that into some kind of risk to the recycled project is a misapplication of what I've been talking about.
Let's try to avoid being combative in our discussion. That would be helpful, I think.
Well, and there was last year a discussion, there was a bill in Sacramento where...
Hertzberg's bill that would
preclude
use of an outfall. Yeah.
It sort of enforce and mandate that wastewater agencies stop having outfalls into the ocean.
By 2026.
Yeah. That died nowhere. So thankfully it became a non-issue now. At some point I think we'll hear it again or talk about it again. But I mean, that was why we were discussing it last year more actively, mm-hmm. was because if it had passed, obviously that would have put it into more of our near future. I definitely think it's more of a capital replacement discussion as opposed to a regulatory one, at least at this point, because it's come up a couple times and died both times.
I will point out that Senator Hertzberg is now chair of the Natural Resources and Water Committee. So I'm sure he has. It'll be interesting to see his portfolio of introduced bills next month.
Yeah. But it wouldn't be just us. It would be every single wastewater agency that has that ocean outfall. So
including all of the ones that are doing recycled water.
Right. So but that was why it was such an active discussion this past year.
I just wondered what people do with that byproduct if they don't have an ocean outfall. It's ignorance on my part.
Yeah.
Now, I'm not trying to be combative. I'm just trying
to
understand.
The desal plants have the same problem.
Yeah.
Right.
What do they do with it, though?
I think a lot of them just throw it in the ocean.
Yeah, I think there's probably a fair amount of research that could be tapped on the Coastal Commission's website, because they looked at a lot of desal projects and ocean outfalls and recycling. Hmm. So there's probably some good
research. And there are inland plants that recycle, so obviously they have to do something with it. It's not something that we need to address at this point, because we do still have that as an option. But if it comes up again, obviously we'll be talking about it much broader, all of the agencies, CETO, UEA, CASA, all of them will be talking about what does this mean, because we would certainly not be the only one.
Yeah, I was just watching a NOAA program where, there are all these cylinders full of nuclear materials, and they're just laying around in a big field,
Yeah, that's a huge cost addition, because I've seen the plants in Southern California where they've had evaporators and crystallizers. So they literally turn into salts. And what happened was one of the plants actually converted into salts, and it was like a white blanket out there.
Mm.
But then what happened was the birds, when they were flying, did not realize that those were salts. They got caught in the salts thing. And then the whole plant had to be stopped, and there was a lot of violations and all that.
Wow.
So there are various means of crystallizing.
Yeah. Sounds like a Sully for the sewer plant.
Yeah.
Huh?
So,
I don't mean to be a nervous now. No,
no.
Yeah,
no, it's okay. It's important to raise those questions.
Well,
and
we can certainly,
I see one place.
We will certainly be getting a report from SRT as we move through this process about all of the implications for any of these things.
Well, it's an impact. It's an impact of
yes.
the project, so they'll have to look at it.
It doesn't stop the project.
Now, are there any other questions here? I do have a member of the public. did you want to address the recycled water? Could I ask your indulgence to listen to Kellex Nelson of the RCD on this
sure.
item? Okay. Would you like to stand up? And
sure, thanks. I'm sorry that I missed the public comment period, didn't get here in time. I know that you are all working through all the thorny details of trying to figure out how to move forward this project, and I wanted to zoom out for a minute and say thank you and remind you of all the people who are grateful for your work on this and the eyes that are on this project. So for those who don't know me, my name is Kellex Nelson. I'm the executive director of the Resource Conservation District, or RCD. And in 2008, we completed the Pilar Cedos Creek Integrated Watershed Management Plan. And the idea of that watershed plan was to try to move forward with a broadly endorsed plan for managing all of the resources of the watershed, including competing demands in the watershed. So in this really small watershed, you've got, a city, a quarry, a landfill, agriculture, recreation, protected open space, endangered species, two different water utilities, and sewer authority. And it's like a perfect, it's like a test tube for case study in watershed management. And so in 2006, 2007, 2008, a very diverse group of people came together to try to identify what are some of the biggest needs and management strategies for this watershed. SAM was one of the signatories to that, CCWD was one of the signatories to that, the RCD, resource agencies like National Marine Fisheries Service, Department of Fish and Game, environmental groups, Farm Bureau, and the Recycled Water Project was identified as the top priority in the watershed plan, the number one priority of everything that was brought up by land trusts, open space, agriculture, utilities, and resource agencies. And one of the reasons for that is that the potential for this to provide water while reducing dependence on the creek, which is home to threatened steelhead trout. So the potential for this project to provide water for agriculture, for the golf course, for the creek, depending on how it's designed and how water storage is designed, and how water is conveyed, can also have just tremendous benefits for the aquatic resources in the creek. Part of the reason I also bring that up is I don't know if everybody's familiar with the fact that recently the resource agencies completed a recovery plan for steelhead trout that makes steelhead a higher priority and enables funding for projects that are beneficial to steelhead trout. And so I think that it's possible that it opens up some new pathways for funding for a recycled water project in Half Moon Bay that are associated with fisheries restoration and are really beneficial for the whole watershed. So I wanted to just bring it back to that, remind you of that, thank you for your work, let you know there's a lot of people who are really excited that this is moving forward, and if anybody at any point wants to talk to me about that, including the partners that were identified, you have a lot of partners out there who want to help you with this, and they're identified in that plan. And it includes the RCD resource agencies, state and federal resource agencies. There's a lot of partners who are ready to help you. So as you're focused sort of inward on all the things you have to grapple with, beyond that, there's a lot of others out there who are ready to help.
Kellex, is it financially?
Yeah. And just so you know, Kellex and I talked a little bit about this previously, and I did mention to SRT because they had also mentioned that there might be some grant opportunities with SFPUC or some other agencies with regards to what we're doing with the watershed and dependency on things like Hetch Hetchy and other fragile water sources. So we'll certainly, as we step through this process and get those numbers a little bit more firm through the design process, we'll certainly be sitting down and talking to all of those different possibilities to see if we can identify realistic grant opportunities to offset the cost of the project. But the first part of it, as you know, is to get the 25% design.
Right.
And so naturally, the partnership and funding opportunities are tied to the designs and what the objectives are. So if it's integrated objectives, you know, if it has objectives that are beneficial for stream flow, therefore for steelhead trout, and that's going to open up a lot of opportunities.
Yeah, I noticed that for a lot of the different Proposition 1 grant rounds that different agencies have, that the projects that are weighted highest have multi-benefits,
yes.
Right? For species,
yes.
On down. So it would make us more competitive to, you know, tie into that.
In any way I can be of help with that, I'm pretty dialed with a lot of these. I'd be happy to, and I know you are as well.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm happy to help with that.
Good, thanks. Anybody else?
You know, I'd like to go back to that saltwater, the effluent from the reverse osmosis system. Prior to this, my understanding, we talked about microfiltration, and that it was only recently that reverse osmosis was really made part of this whole package. And so the question, I think it is legitimate to ask, you know, with that change of the effluent from a reverse osmosis process, is it of the scale it has any effect? Is it different than the microfiltration we had before? Or is there, you know, just a quick, you know, address the issue that how it's going to be either diluted before it gets flows in the ocean or it's not going to be diluted? There's been no mention of how that gets handled at all. And that is really, in my mind, a new development.
So this is microfiltration with reverse osmosis run about half of the time. So reverse osmosis will happen downstream of the microfiltration, which will happen on all the water, and then about half of it will have the RO to do a finishing pass, and that's to help get the salts balanced down.
But I would still like the staff to comment on it. I want an engineered statement on it.
Yeah, the microfiltration is, the water is going to be tertiary treated. And then you go through the RO. So if, so the 48% blend what we're talking of, the RO requirement is 48%. So 48% passes through the RO, the balance just gets tertiary treated and then goes to the outfall.
And there's no need to monitor it, dilute it, change it, or anything like that?
The tertiary treated effluent after MF, after microfiltration.
After RO?
No.
Okay.
I think the question being asked is the addition of brine to the effluent that will be discharged is an issue. That's what I think you're asking.
Yeah. Thanks, Bruce. That is why.
So if I understand right, what you're saying is on the RO reject, which is the brine.
Yeah.
Does it have to be diluted before you send it to the outfall? Am I right? Is that the question you're asking?
Correct. Mm-hmm.
Okay. It actually mixes with the effluent and then goes to the outfall.
Okay, so that...
So it doesn't get diluted separately.
Okay.
It just gets mixed to the effluent and then goes to the outfall.
Okay.
And as you see, the sodium levels will definitely be slightly higher than what it is to the effluent, but it will still be acceptable to when it goes to the outfall.
And let's say that conditions change, and instead of a 48% blend, you have to use the reverse osmosis 70% of the time. Is that going to drastically or in any meaningful way affect anything?
No, it will not, because then what would happen would be 70-30, so only 30% of the effluent would go direct to the outfall, and of the 70%, the reject is going to be literally 20% of the 70%. What happens in an RO is, if you send in 100% of water to the RO,
yep,
then you get 80% as recycled water, mm-hmm, and you get 20% as the reject.
Right.
So that's approximately a thumb rule. So if you increase it to 70%, then it will be 30% goes straight to the outfall, the effluent, and the balance, the 30% will be 20% of the 30% will come as a brine recovery and get mixed to the effluent.
Okay.
Yeah, no, I really appreciate it. I'm just sorry to ask all the questions.
No, it's okay. No problem.
Makes me shake when I think about it, because I just don't understand.
Well, and that's part of the reason I think why the request was for each task to sort of go through this rigor and questions, and that everybody is comfortable with it from the SAM board before we take the next step, so that we don't get all the way to the end and then somebody asks an important question that would have been better had we asked at task one or task two. So by stepping through the tasks one by one, that gives us the ability to stop and do a check-in.
Okay.
Yeah, I guess as a informational item, have you been contacted by the people from POST yet, the Peninsula Open Space Trust, regarding their interest in this?
Nobody's contacted us.
Have you?
Well, I did meet with the woman and gave her...
That's doing their study.
Yeah, I gave her Keishan and Beverly's contact information.
Yeah, they came to me. They have been interested in recycled water for some time because of their interest in supporting agriculture.
Excuse me.
For them, the issue was distribution, of course. I mean, how do they get this water to certain agricultural users? The reservoir on the east side of Highway 1, they're currently using for the agricultural use on that property. This is near the Johnson House, that reservoir. We own the water in that reservoir, but we allow them to utilize it because we can't get it to the golf course. And I'm not interested in processing any kind of pipe system. And it's very silted up, that reservoir. It's about at 10% of its capacity. But so we, a long time ago, allowed them to use that water as they saw fit for their agricultural use. They have approached me now twice about, you know, whether or not we could work out at some point some distribution to their property in Wavecrest. Interesting. and west, east of the highway, and how much more capacity would the system have, and how much they would need, and then keep working on that, I think. Walter Moore and I, when Audrey was running Post, we had these discussions many, many years ago about them using our well water if they could. I think this is all down the road, but what, your question of expansion, I think, is an important one, that these systems are sufficient. I don't think they would be an enormous user for their property on the east side. Getting to the east side is not as difficult as you would think, coming out of Wavecrest Road and, you know, dealing with Caltrans. Getting to other places is more difficult, south, but there are some users that could be, you know, reached relatively easily. I think that they, not necessarily in this phase, but I think it's something to keep that line of communication with them open, because I think that if you can get to the east side of the highway, you can get to other users on the east side that are near them, that would be a much more significant user of water, of recycled water.
Potential greenhouse users.
Yeah, yeah. And I think their interest that other, it's not, I forget the name of the company, you know, that one, the guy, Jerry Rice's.
Soil farm?
Yeah, the soil farm, aren't they right there?
Yeah, oh yeah.
He's got that, they use a lot of water.
They do.
They need water. And once you get to the east side, it would be hard getting to them either, and some of the nursery uses on that side.
Well, Eddie Andrini Jr. also expressed interest as part of the new cement batch plant.
Yeah. So, and I think Post is interested sufficiently in this, where I think it's talking about another phase. I don't think it's part of this, but a phase where they would participate in the financing of that distribution line. I think they're pretty interested in that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'll let them speak for themselves in terms of what that means to them, but they're much, very much interested in supporting the ongoing agriculture on the coast as part of their kind of perspective of mm-hmm. things. As well as open space, and I think that's a really important kind of lead to continue to pursue with them.
Yeah.
I mean, we'd be happy to, you know, work out with you and have some arrangement where they would come off our pipeline or share the water.
I had hoped that they would jump in at the time that we spoke, you know, while SRT was just sort of gearing up on the 25% design.
Yeah. I think their stuff is it's just too far away right now, and I think they want to see, frankly, that this group collectively can pull off the first phase of this. I think they might be a little suspect of that, given the history and the duration.
That sounds rational.
Yeah, not to put a downer on things, but
right.
I think they want to kind of watch and see whether this really can get pulled off.
Mm-hmm. We could always call Vegas and see what the current odds are right now. They're getting for us.
Let's look it up.
But I think that's a good thing down the road.
Yeah, I agree. Anybody else? Okay, so that brings us to item D, which is adjournment.
No, I'm sorry. Number C.
Oh,
yeah, we gotta go to C.
I'd like to jump into something too, a report, Eddie, when we have a chance.
Yeah, you're left
over. And this item B? Or?
It's really a separate new item that sort of.
We could probably just do a closing discussion if anybody has anything of note.
Sure.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. Go ahead.
It's an important new thing popped up that I just found out about.
So the thing on the item C is that back at the November 8th CCWD meeting, I understand there was a conversation about recycled water and the production capacity and an interest in. Funding sort of an expansion of the scope of services for SRT to do an analysis of basically, wouldn't be 100%, but the maximum amount that we could potentially recycle, as I understand it.
That's correct.
But then I never heard anything, so I wasn't really sure.
It's on my list. I was actually.
Oh, okay. And so sooner rather than later, obviously, if that was something that you were interested in, because obviously the farther they get done with the 25% design, certainly I'm sure they could add that in, but I would think you would want them to add that in sooner rather than later.
Yeah.
Yeah, we'd like to talk about that now.
And that's why I put that on there, so that we could open up that discussion, because we do have, if it were something that you wanted us to take back to the SAM board, the first possible time would be the February 13th meeting.
Yeah, that'd be great. Yeah, because we really would like to know how the project could be expanded to produce maximum flow from SAM. And we'd like to know how the project could produce the highest capacity at the highest possible quality level. And we at the CCWD are willing to, we understand that would be an increased scope in the project, and we would love to see a proposal so that we could take it to our board and approve that proposal and add that to the scope of work. We're kind of interested as a board in buying as much water as you can produce. That's our goal, because we feel that the sustainability of this resource is infinite. We feel that it causes us to rely less on local sources and also on the Hetchy system. So we feel it's an advantage. We feel it's a more guaranteeable source for us in the long run. And that's the reason for my questions about the outfall, because we would like to see it go forever. And so we'd like to understand what the risks might be of that, depending on that water. And the other thing is, we're very interested, and that was the reason for the questions about the space, in understanding, you know, what would happen or what it would take to go from 50% RO to 100%. And so we would just like to understand the other end of the spectrum. We're excited to have a customer. We think that's really great in the short run. We think having a pilot project is, you know, a really advantage, you know, to the whole community, showing that we can work together and, you know, figuring out a way to utilize these sources. But we think there are going to be much greater needs, much larger needs, and we think there are going to be multiple customers in the future. We don't know how that'll work or how we'll get that distributed, or we know there's lots of things to work out, just like we're still trying to figure out how to get a contract so we can move this forward. And I know that one of my cohorts in the committee is very interested in setting up a schedule. But we'd also like it to be a long-range schedule, because we would like to use all of it. We'd like all of it.
So if I could clarify my understanding of what you're asking for, would be, so there were three alternatives that they did. You would like a fourth alternative, which would be, what would this look like if we were to do 100% RO?
Correct. Or what would be a step, an interim step, to get to that ultimate place?
An add-on, another phase.
Yes.
Right. So not 100% from day one, but what would it, is it possible? And if it is possible, how would it look? And what would that potential cost be? Do you want two alternatives? Because one would be do 100, you know, assume build and do everything for 100% day one. The other would be do this day one, and then at some point in the future, add on.
Yeah, I think that's a great question. I'm not sure I can really answer that. I think
I'd like to address that question. First of all, I think your comment was 100% utilization of your effluent,
right?
And at 100% RO,
right?
So 1,000,002 gallons. That's about what you can produce, right, Dave? 1,000,002.
Close to that.
Yeah, 1,000,002. And second, what would it be if it was 100% RO? I caution you. This is not to define this project broadly enough to require different environmental analysis,
EIR,
and speculative distribution, mm-hmm. and questions that you can't answer now. It's one thing for this project to be narrowly defined. We have a distribution system, we have a creek crossing, we have environmental issues that can be quantified and studied in the environmental documents, and the resource agencies can address that. It's one thing to do a theoretical analysis or a study of what might happen in the future, but I would caution you not to define the project as including that as a phase or something that might occur in phase two,
yeah.
Because then you're going to be dealing with foreseeability issues, like, for example, where's the other distribution going? Where are the pipelines going? Are they going under other creeks? Are they going in environmentally sensitive areas? We kind of faced this several years ago, getting too broad in terms of a potential second and third phase. It's one thing to talk about is this feasible? What would it mean to run 100 million 2 gallons at 100% RO? Is there enough room here? Is the facility going to be able to handle that? But to start to get into more than just an theoretical study of that, but actually defining the project as including that as a possibility here, I think will get you into a much broader legal analysis and environmental analysis.
So you want a separate project?
Well, I'm assuming that 25% design means that we're not going to get anywhere near what you're talking about. Because they're just going to talk about can it be done and what would the cost be.
Yeah.
But it's going to be at a real, you know, kind of a high-level analysis. We're not going to be really drafting an EIR for that project. I mean, necessary.
That can't be the project as well.
Right, yeah. Well, yeah. One is like a white paper.
Well, a 25%, you know, kind of an overview of what it would be. And that's why my space was, you know, the reason I'm worried about space is I would just like to be sure.
Sure.
Because I'd hate to be in a position where all of a sudden there really was a demand.
So maybe you contract separately with either SRT or KJ and SRT?
I think SRT actually had a part of their original analysis. I think that there was another stage that we didn't select that looked like they were going to look further or at more capacity, if I'm not mistaken. I think that's how I read it. So there was kind of a little, there were two or three additions to this initial study. And I think one of them talked about, you know, larger capacities.
Well, they did talk about potential future customers.
Yeah.
You know, in a sort of a cursory way.
Correct. But in this case, just to let you guys know, this technical memorandum was prepared considering that the influent capacity is 1.3. Okay. Mm-hmm. I'm sorry, it's 1 million tons. So now 1 million gets changed to 1.2, 1.3. You can see how much is the additional cost. And when you talk 100% RO, right now we're talking about 48% RO because the influent quality is good.
Mm-hmm.
But it's not that good enough to serve the customer.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why we're saying 48% RO.
Mm-hmm.
100% RO means our influent quality is very bad, which I don't think we would reach to that stage. You get what I'm saying? Because the sodium level percentage, sodium and chloride percentages, whatever we've analyzed, like taking the composite samples, we found out that 48% RO is good enough for the golf course.
Right.
So I don't think we would reach a stage where we would need 100% RO. I understand 100% capacity, but when you talk of 100% RO, that means the sodium is way high.
Mm.
Would you be saying that you want them to analyze it for a different quality of water, because that would be different.
Potable reuse.
Correct.
Right, because that would be, I think, the trigger, not the volume. It really has to do with what is your end use, because they're doing everything
drinking
right now based on the project that we talked about, which was the quality and quantity as specified, which I believe was different than potable reuse.
Correct. So what I understand is you would want us to consider the entire capacity of the plant.
Right.
If you're getting an influent of about 3 million gallon, then you would like to get the best possible using the 3 million.
The highest possible flow.
Correct.
Yeah.
That's what you're saying.
And the highest possible quality.
Correct. So 100% capacity.
And
so
the highest possible quality.
And
for the same auto quality what we're getting.
Yes.
No. Treat on.
No.
I'm talking about potable reuse.
So he's looking at a quote to... for an alternative to this, which would be making different assumptions. The first assumption is we can recycle as much of it as feasibly possible given what we need.
Correct.
And two is that the use would not be assuming the golf course, use would be assuming 100% potable reuse, and we deliver it to you, and then what you do with it is what
that's
you do
correct.
With it.
We buy
and
all
part
of
it.
Yes.
And
like
so
ideas.
You would like us to go back to the SAM board and ask SRT to give us a quote for that alternative to be added to this.
Correct.
And that, based on that quote, you would potentially go to your board and ask.
Yes, and then I think what would happen is, based on the reasonableness of that quote, we would make a decision and we would write a check for that amount of money to add to the program. And we're not trying to stall it or mess around with it. We just would like to look further into it. We'd like more information. We think we could go to Kennedy Jenks or someone else, but we think that's not reasonable. I mean, SRT is in it, they're in it deep, mm-hmm. they already know, and
yeah,
you think that's,
add-on, yeah.
that's gonna be the most efficient use of money, I think.
When is your next meeting?
14th, Valentine's
Day. So it's
Day.
The day after ours. Yeah. So I was just trying to think of the steps of this, because obviously the SAM board would have to agree that that's proper use of staff time to go and work with SRT and get the quote. And
we would want a proposal in writing from CCWD.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes, yeah. Something from CCWD that I could then take to the SAM board on the 13th and then let you know what that the SAM board was okay or not okay with that.
Yeah, that's what we'd like.
So I think at this point, what I would need is something officially from CCWD with those parameters defined and,
yes.
and the request to get that. And then once we have that, we could discuss it with the SAM board and make sure that that's a direction that they want to go as far as staff resources. And then if it is, then obviously Kishan can reach out to SRT and ask what that would cost.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that would be great. Yeah, we would really appreciate it.
So if I could get that from you, then I can present that to the SAM board.
Yeah, I think it gives us a longer range map, and I think the interest, at least at our board level, was very positive mm-hmm. to look at a bigger use of the water. I think it's important. Yeah, if that meets with everyone in the committee, I mean, sure. it would be nice if we made a recommendation as a group, I think, too.
Okay. Did you have anything?
I have another quick subject to bring in. It's not really for a major discussion, but it's a advisory notice I just mm-hmm. discovered. Last week I went to the LAFCO meeting and the over in Redwood City, and the key project that was coming through LAFCO at that date is something very similar to ours. West Bay Sanitary District is the lead agency for a recycled water project over there. This is going to be for the Sharon Heights golf course, and phase two is Stanford Slack down there, the linear accelerator project. Some interesting things real quick on that was that they've got it's a $15 million project, so it's bigger than ours, of course. They got a $5 million grant and a $10 million loan at 1%.
Wow.
Boom, so that's good news. But what was interesting is I'm sitting there and saying, why is this at LAFCO? And I discovered during the meeting, and I talked to Martha several times afterwards, Martha Poyatos, I hadn't seen this on another project, especially we could talk maybe Coastside County, North Coast County Water did one. Her explanation was all agencies probably have latent powers, and you folks, CCWD, will be the water purveyor under our project, like West Bay Sanitary. They were required, and this isn't really onerous or anything, or it doesn't slow the project down, they were required to make an application to LAFCO to awake their latent power of recycled water. They have, I don't know if this is exactly the same for you guys, whether you officially have latent recycled water powers. This might be a good conversation to have with Martha pretty soon, and I'll join in if you want.
Yeah, cool.
But the whole thing at LAFCO was for the LAFCO board to approve the awakening of the recycled water powers so they could, you know, run the project through. There was no resistance or anything like that. It was 100% approval. Everybody supported it and everything like that. But I wouldn't want us to go along and all of a sudden say, Martha, say, oh, wait a minute, you got about a 3-month process here to get these things, you got to have meetings, their meetings are every 2 months, so I would like to get that into the schedule, A, if it's true. We can call Coastside County Water District up north to see what they did, I mean, North Coast County Water, because they did a golf course project up there. Did they go through LAFCO? I don't know. Because I just found out about this, but it can go in parallel with all the grant applications, so it won't shut the project down or even slow it down, but I don't want it to cause a problem in the future.
Mm-hmm.
So So I don't know if you have a book which says what your latent powers are, or anything like that, or if you've ever thought of this before, because I'd never heard of it. I mean, Granada did parks, but we didn't have latent park powers. We had, we just went and got them. Mm-hmm. So I don't know all the logistics that this is really a serious problem. I don't, it's not a serious problem no matter what, mm-hmm. but it's a bureaucratic thing. We just need to get in so we don't lose time mm-hmm. because of lack of.
Well, we can so, certainly find out.
So I would take notes. If we want to have a meeting with her, I'm willing to pop to the meeting.
Oh, she's a phone call away. She's, yeah, yeah. She's very close.
So let's, she can explain she's everything, great. And she would be able to look in to see if, you know, all water districts automatically have this power, hmm. which would be a reasonable assumption, I would think. So, anyway.
She won't have a $5 million grant or backlog.
No. That's the other group's problem, but... just you know, it might be interesting just for people or something to get maybe get a presentation from West Bay to come out here mm-hmm. and just say, hey, at one of our meetings, just give them a half an hour show. Hey, here's what we did. We got $15 million for our project. You know, yeah, that might be some good things for us to talk about in the future.
So Rick, I didn't quite get that. It was a $15 million project, and how did they get
financed? They got $5 million in pure grants. And okay. $10 million in 1% loans.
Okay.
It's the state revolving fund, and yeah. they match it with the Prop 1A monies. And yeah. My understanding from what just recently came out from the state is that those they're suddenly starting to get a lot more grant applications than they had previously. Obviously, there are a lot of us out there trying to do recycled water. One of the things that I heard was that, much like Kellex mentioned, that if you can piggyback on another issue, either some sort of environmental issue like greenhouse gas emissions or
creek restoration,
if you have a solar project that's going with it, something like that where you can take advantage of sort of multiple, solving multiple problems with one project, it doesn't fast track you, but it makes you sexier to the state, and those are the projects that are getting the second look.
Yeah, and especially projects that have a water energy mix. You know, if you can reduce, first of all, if you can, you know, localize your supply, and then if you can reduce the amount of energy that you use to produce your drinking water, your wastewater.
Yeah. And that's, you know, the downside of, I mean, we're not late to the game, but the downside of being a little bit slower than some of the other projects is, of course, everybody's in a rush to take advantage, but... certainly, if we come in with partnerships like SFPUC or the RCD or any of those kinds of things, I think it definitely makes them want to look at us because we're not going to them just as a sole source. So we'll certainly be taking a look at that.
Anybody else? Okay, is there a motion to adjourn?
Well, before we adjourn, we probably should talk about
how we're going to meet.
Yeah, because, I mean, I don't think it's worth having a meeting just for a meeting. I know all of you just love to get together, and certainly staff really enjoys these conversations, but it seems to me a more useful, worthwhile of our time is to meet when we have sort of like something like this where we have the task one. So perhaps the next we could discuss would be if we had task two, or if everything got approved and we went forward and got an alternative from SRT or something like that, unless you wanted to have a check-in. It just seemed like monthly, there's not enough movement to meet monthly. Do you want to wait for there to be something, or do you want to just say every other?
Through the chair, you know, we've had some discussion today about potential partners. I mean, does it make sense to have a meeting with potential partners where we invite them in and ask them what their interest is in recycled water and, you know, kind of go head to head with them and say, hey, do you want to join the effort? I mean, maybe it's a way to make them feel empowered. Maybe that's a good use of our time, is to talk to people who could really help us.
I think that's, you know, kind of imperative, really. And, you know, we can allow staff to take care of it, or if the board's interested, board and staff, you know, meeting with them. And I certainly would enjoy meeting with them and hearing what the options are, opportunities are.
I think, like we discussed earlier, we don't want to hurt the golf course project, or we don't want to bring these people in and they say, okay, boom, I'm on board, let's go.
Well, I don't think they're talking about a different project. They're talking about this project, you know, being designed in an integrated way where it's producing multiple benefits.
Sure.
So they're talking about the existing project.
Okay.
The one thing I think in talking with both Tony Yarovsky from SRT and Kellogg's is that really that step of it is after the 25% design, because until you have the project to sort of put in front of them, they're trying to figure out how it's going to integrate. So that might be once we get to that point, the 25% design, because then that's also when we take the little dog and pony show up to the state and start talking to them officially about the project. I mean, we've already put it on their radar, and Kishin's already gone up there with Director Lohman. But really, a lot of these grants, and you have to have sort of the four corners of that project defined. And then I think that's an excellent opportunity. But certainly, staff can continue to have those conversations to see if there's something we need to include in the design to take advantage of it. Mm-hmm. But I think that 25% design point.
They're interested, you know, water for the creek, you know, water for fish. Riparian restoration associated with any, you know, impacts. But it would be nice to sort of, you know, pin them down. It's nice to have an offer of help, but what are they talking about?
Well, and like I said, I've already, Kishin and I already had this brief conversation with Tanya about other projects where they've been able to piggyback on some of these. So certainly, I would imagine we'd be having that conversation as we get closer to the end of that 25% design, because obviously cost is part of, I think, task two. So based on that, perhaps we have our next meeting either when there's something to talk about on this expanded scope or when we have task two ready,
mm-hmm.
which worst case scenario would
end
be
March.
End of March maybe.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and if somebody has something they want to discuss, you know, send out an email. You know, I'd like to convene the Recycled Water Committee to talk about.
Mm-hmm.
Could we meet? Is there interest in meeting? You know, so could be on an ad hoc basis as well.
Yeah.
I'd like to see us make sure on the next agenda, whenever we do meet, that we talk specifically about project management schedule, anticipated next steps. It drives me crazy to come to a meeting where that's not on the agenda and not discussed. This is not the best use of meetings.
I agree with you, and we need to move
into
a
formal one.
Yeah.
No. I'm just saying we have a lot of talk.
Yeah.
We're spending a lot of money.
Mm-hmm.
We're putting our money where our mouth is.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it would be beneficial if each party came to the table with their idea of what next steps might be for their portion of it.
Maybe have input into the agenda, you know, like what sort of discrete actions do we want on the agenda that will move us forward?
Well, I'm talking about specifically just in terms of this project, the
yeah.
one that we defined, that we all signed a letter about how we were defining this
That's
project.
That's what I'm talking about, too.
And making sure that we're actually making progress as best we can. I mean, if we know that the next time we get together, we get the SRT report, and we start to have some tangible data that CCWD can use to evaluate financial feasibility. Well, not just financial, but feasibility overall. I think we should be prepared for a positive answer, given what we know, and try to hit the ground running. We've spent over 10 years working on this, 12 so far, and really I think we're able to get more than this done. I would really like to see us taking, you know, every time we meet, taking deliberate steps of checking things off that project management
mm-hmm.
checklist about how we're getting there. But we don't have that checklist in front of us, so it's a little hard to stay focused on that.
A checklist or like a Gantt chart that shows,
yep.
you know, flow,
project
work
plan,
flow,
stones,
critical
next steps,
flow stones, yeah.
Hold it. Yep.
Excuse me, Kishin can work with SRT and we can put that together. Obviously, it would be from our site, so CCWD would need to bring their whatever steps they have, because
mm-hmm.
obviously that would be separate from our steps.
Mm-hmm.
We can certainly do that on, and we can just have that as a recurring item
yeah.
on the, going forward on the agendas.
But I do think, I agree with you that we should have action items on our agendas.
Okay.
Action items, updates.
Somewhat staying with that, this item B, we discussed the SRT report, but we really didn't come to any conclusions outside of that we want to, report on 100% usage of 100% RO. But are we saying we're in favor of the recommendation of the what's been proposed here by SRT is, item one, option one on both the way to distribute it and the way to do the system? Well, we really haven't weighed in on it.
What we're doing is reporting on Sam's action, the approval of the money to fund the 25% project, which we're anticipating we may have that work done and reportable to this group by the end of March. So it's more an update on the work that Sam has been doing.
Yep. Because the project itself is really, as far as Sam's concerned, it's two pieces. It's the recycled water on Sam's side, and then obviously CCWD is looking at their side. And so we're reporting on the Sam side. And the relationship is between Sam and CCWD. And obviously OCP is at the table because right now they're the identified end user. But as far as Sam is concerned, you know, the agreement and everything is between Sam and CCWD. So those are sort of the two pieces I see sort of simultaneously moving forward. And then I assume there's a conversation that CCWD is having with OCP about whatever they need to have happen on their side. And all three of these things are sort of, I hope, running parallel to each other so that when we get done, and somebody might get done before somebody else, but that we're all sort of aiming at the same endpoint, whatever that timeline is going to be. Obviously, each one of us has pieces of that has to happen. Mm-hmm. And so I think it does make sense to have that, if each of us has a the Gantt chart or the project flow chart, and we could just check in and see where we are with that. I think that's important. But this committee is more of a sharing of information at this point because it's not a decision making. And certainly if there's a recommendation, but at this point Sam has already proceeded that alternative one is the most feasible alternative given what's been presented to Sam.
Bring some show and tell.
So in other words, Bill, you can have an opinion about it, but it's been decided.
Okay.
That's what
and it was decided before this meeting.
Yes.
Yes, it was decided at the Sam.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
I think to your point, I was just looking back at the minutes that we approved, and I don't mean this to sound a bit frustrating, but I think there can be other things that we can be doing unless it's the perspective of everybody that until we see some economic confirmation that this is viable, we're not going to start doing a lot of work. We have been talking about starting to prepare contracts between the various entities and outlining it now for at least the last 6 or 7 months. Those contracts are out to everybody. There have been term sheets distributed. I think at the last meeting I suggested that maybe at some point CCWD, that's going to be the lead entity in processing this application, decide who they're going to use. Or maybe we're just, this is a sequential process where we're not going to do anything until step one gets done, then step two. I think if we're going to try to, you know, stick to a 2.5 or 3 year time period, it's going to be really difficult to pull that off, waiting for every step to get accomplished before we move on to the next.
Sequential as opposed to multi-term.
Yeah, Bruce, it seemed to me like there was this initial sequential phase until we hit the 25% drawing.
That's it, fine with me.
And then we go out for grants, funding, CEQA. But I think our main agreement is we got to see that number. Are we all going to be happy with the number SRT brings us to us? We think so. But when we see that number, then everything goes in parallel then.
Explodes. Yeah. It'll explode at that point.
Well, I'm ready to sit down with CCWD and start talking about a
major
contract. We have proposals to dredge our ponds and engineering proposals to do the drawings and prepare the information that whoever's filing the application will need. We're ready whenever everybody else is ready.
Well, and I think part of that is also the way Sam was given approval from the three member agencies on how to proceed, and it was done in such a way that sort of each step along the way and no more expenses than that was associated with each of those tasks. So it is sort of creating this step-by-step process. I think once we get to the point of the 25% design that we see the financial feasibility, I think at that point it can really take off, because then all three member agencies can assess their buy-in to the project.
Sounds like Bruce is ready.
Yes.
So I've got a question about
we've been ready for 8 years.
I've got a question about the single track versus multi-track. Right now, Sam's the one spending money. We're putting ourselves out there. Is everybody else holding back for the next 2-3 months to wait and see, or would it be that big a deal to go ahead and have attorneys sit down and start trying to draft out the contracts?
Well, I was going to say, I don't see any problem with that. You know, we want to be careful of the money, but certainly Bruce on his end could start, you know, doing some...
Well, we've delivered, the San Francisco contract between all the golf courses and San Francisco to everybody. We've indicated that what we think of that contract, and we've prepared a list of other points that we think need to be addressed in a user contract.
Mm-hmm.
We're ready to see an outline prepared by somebody. I assume it would be the water district and their lawyers. I mean, we're ready to start reading something.
Because it seemed like when we talked with the group in Sacramento with Kishin that I would think that the granting funding agencies want to see the contract.
Yeah.
So you don't want to put that off at the end. And
right.
If you folks can get all the verbiage of the contracts and all the cancellation clauses and all that stuff done, minus the number that goes in, I mean, you could beat all that up ahead of time, and then when we come in with the money, and then you folks have a contract, and then we attach that to the grant application, which is, hey, we're moving, you know, we got the contracts, the users are signed up, we're gone, we just need your approval. So I think writing the contracts would be a great thing to do now.
Grant makers are going to want to know that there's commitments for funding. Yeah.
So how can we get those started?
Well, I've already been working on draft contract language, but Sam doesn't really have the funding identified for sending it out to legal counsel. That there was very limited amount of money that was put in the approval for that. Certainly, as we get closer to the completion of that, I think we can go back to the three member agencies and certainly ask for.
Could you make sure that's on the next agenda, that we can discuss about how we can get that money? We might be able to find it.
Let's get the money.
We might be able to find it so we can get it going. I don't want us to be, we should be the first ones out there on all of this stuff.
Okay.
Kind of waiting, hoping you're going to say something.
Like money?
Well, you know, you have to realize that in the beginning of our discussions, the kinds of numbers that we came out with on the project made the project look like it wasn't feasible. So we entered into 25% design for a purpose, and that is to see the numbers. And we're waiting to see the numbers. So if that's end of March, that's when we'll see the numbers. I don't know how to hurry that up. Now, if they can do it at the end of February, we'll look at them in the end of February.
Well, he could start the contract, so if we...
So if Sam can put $200,000 into action today, and it is, what can CCWD do? Where can you meet us on this?
Well, what we're willing to do is increase the study to look for more end users.
That doesn't get contracts written. What can you do to meet us on getting this thing going?
We can discuss the idea of initiating contract negotiations, but without a number, I don't understand how you do that.
So we're putting ourselves out there with all this money from our ratepayers on spec, hoping that when we get to the end of it, at the end of March, that there's going to be like this epiphany, and now we can turn on.
Yeah, I mean, that's what we've been going for the last four months.
In the contract, there's a lot more in the contract other than the number.
Well, understand that.
If we can get all the rest of that stuff worked out, like what happens if so-and-so cancels or fails and all those contract stuff.
Form of agreement.
Just so we don't lose two more months on that.
Yeah, I guess here's the way I see it. I would have a difficult time entering into a contract to produce a certain landscape project without knowing the cost of the materials that I was going to purchase to put into that job on a fixed price. I couldn't do that. I could do it on a time and materials basis. I mean, I could do it on a the number doesn't matter basis, where we would just negotiate terms and whatever the cost was the cost.
You've talked over the years about the kinds of things that need to be in a contract.
Right.
Bruce has very helpfully brought forward real, honest-to-goodness contracts that are in force today with multiple parties that were obviously very, very challenging to work out, but they hammered it all out. I would hate to think that we come to the last day of March and we only then start looking at the materials that have been helpfully provided and see how they address the kind of concerns that you've been putting on the table about how costs are apportioned and who does what. All this stuff is, the issues are not new, and the only possible benefit that I can see to hanging on to the end of March is if somehow the number comes in well over anything that we've estimated. And CCWD has to wash their hands of it and walk away.
Yeah, I don't know about that. I haven't seen the numbers.
It was my understanding from the very beginning, that's why we're having SRT do this study, so we could get the 25%, so we would have a decent enough number to be able to act on.
Correct.
So that's what we're waiting for.
And
it's only a few weeks.
Yeah, and please understand.
It's two solid months.
2 months.
Two solid months. January, a year ago, CCWD came in, planted a flag in the ground, said we're gonna basically stall the project until we can get 25% done. We have roughly 12% done, and what we're talking about doing is going a little further down that path. But what we all understand, as we take roughly 10% or so. Of an estimated project, and we work our project plan out to twice that. What we're doing is we're dialing in our confidence interval. We're not actually expecting anything to change radically. And so now we're talking about, instead of burning off 12 months, we're burning off 14 months before we can even get to the next most rational step, spending a little bit of money with attorneys trying to hammer out contracts that we think we might be able to and hope to be able to execute. So we can continue with the holding of breath, but we're putting $200,000 up. We've done the work that it takes to go back to three member agencies, sort out between us how and whether we're going to pull that money together. We have pulled together that money. $200,000 ain't chump change. And we, on behalf of our constituents all up and down the coastside, are saying, okay, let's do this. I'd like to see CCWD go ahead and take a step in faith.
Yeah, we're going to take a big step in faith. We're going to get 25% design, and we're going to see what the realities
are.
No, that's not faith.
That's not faith. That's going to be working from a dead certainty.
Well,
at this point.
I think we spent money on water quality. I think we've spent time and energy in our meetings discussing the recycled
water. So I'm just going to go on record, and
I'd
like to see
in
the minutes that
here.
CCWD has decided, is making a point of waiting two more months before taking the next step. I really want to see you guys step up, and I'm going to keep asking, what are we going to be able to see, what are you able to bring and put on the table to show us that we're going forward on this thing?
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to challenge you on that.
Great. Well, challenge accepted. Here I am sitting to tell you that we've been waiting 4 months for a SRT study.
12 months. 12 months from when you
let's get really clear about something, okay? You know, we're attempting to make sure that we protect our customers in the eventuality that there are any issues that would be generated in the recycled water project that would put them at risk. That's what I'm elected to do, all right? We slowed down and we made sure the city was comfortable with the project before the city came in. Why? Out of respect, because they didn't have enough questions answered. And if I was authorized tonight to tell you that we're in 100%, we're ready to negotiate the contracts, you know, without seeing 25% design, which is what we all agreed to, I would tell you that.
Well,
but I'm not.
What I did a year ago was I committed to you that I would go and try to get for my agency our portion of money for the 25% design.
Thank you very much.
I did that.
Thank you.
I call on you to do something similar.
Well, we're working on it.
I'd like to, I call on you to take personal action to go ask your board to get the contracts underway. That's what I'm encouraging you to do.
Just get all the weird language done, and then, you know, all the alternatives, all the options, just, you have samples, you know, that Bruce has provided, just get the contract ready. We don't expect anybody to sign anything.
No.
Just get it ready, so SRT brings us a good number, but he says, okay, one final review of the contract, stick the numbers in, boom, we're gone. And, you know, in a week, you know, then we can package that with the grants, and, because otherwise we just lose 2 months. Let's just admit that, it's just 2 more months.
Cost of construction is not going down.
How about a small step?
I'm more than happy to go to the board and request that.
I'd appreciate that, I think that'd be a solid thing to do.
Be happy to do it. And I hope you understand that at every one of the meetings, you can go back and watch the minutes. That's what I've been asking for, is authorization to proceed. So go back and read, you know, watch the minutes. And if I was authorized by 4 other board members, I'd be...
I'm not saying go, you know, do it yourself.
Authorizing it here.
But you're here on behalf of CCWD representing the board.
Right.
And I hope they've sent you here with some expectation that you're going to bring up things that they may want to do.
They sent me here to receive the report and discuss the aspects of the report that I might have interest in. So I've already discussed that. Space, expandability, additional water up to the maximum. How are we going to treat the outfall? So I hope you've heard all these things, because that's what I was authorized to discuss. And that's what I'm here doing. And as soon as I'm authorized to execute a contract, I'd be happy to do it.
Not asking you to execute it, asking you to get the lawyers to like start hammering
out. To pre-write a contract for a dollar amount uncertain.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Spaces.
You asked us to put our constituents' rate money at risk to satisfy your desire for more certainty about the project. We've done that. I'm asking you to step out and show some good faith on this and get some of this stuff in motion.
Some additional good faith.
Sure.
Yes. I'd like that in the minutes, additional good faith.
If you think waiting until the end of this thing, you know, characterize it as you will, let's get this thing moving.
Let's adjourn this meeting. Let's get SRT to complete. How's that?
Meeting is adjourned. We're done. Meeting's over.